I mean, we had one partnership where we already were giving them a discount on the price per seat, and they wanted something absurdly low, like 1/7 of our price. And we were like, we're just not going to make money at this rate. The clients they were bringing us didn't upgrade anything, and we just told them no. And they left. And that was our first failed expansion into a different niche. But we haven't had anything where we lost time. I mean, the quality of customers you get from different lead sources will vary. You'll start to notice that. And like the customers you're getting from Facebook ads or something are great, and the customers you're getting from Google ads are terrible for some reason, or the customers you're getting from a partner are just awful. And if you find something like that, you need to just kind of raise your prices gradually or tell them that you're not the best fit. And if you're being honest and you're not making any money and the customers aren't happy with you, you're not the best fit for those customers. And if you explain that to people, like, look, we've tried to do this and it's really well worked, it's not really working out. What's the best way we can both kind of back out of this so your customers are better served? Because it seems like we're not really the best company to serve them. And I'm sorry it's taken us so long to figure it out, but I think that's the case. Any other questions? Oh, wow, okay. Roger. Yeah, so this he's building a product to find nannies for families, which is something that's on our mind lately. And I guess, so what I would do, I mean, there's lots of meetup groups. Like, we live in Stapleton, where the parents are a bit militant. And my apologies to anybody else from Stapleton. But it's true. You know it's true. And so there are lots of, like, meetup groups. There are Facebook groups. You need to get in there and just be involved in the community. And if there's any news related to nannies, or you can share content about the cheap places to do background checks for nannies, you know, making references where you can post, you know, people that had great experience with nannies or quotes. But you need to figure out what kind of information your target customers would find useful and that you would be an expert in providing, and then provide that. For us, it was going into dental forums, and people would say, ask questions about how Google worked. Why don't my ads show up? Why is my business non-existent? What's wrong with my Google Plus profile? How can I improve my Facebook page? Why does my website not work on mobile apps? We just answer those questions. We just answer the questions and not ask for anything. There's probably questions like that your customers have. You need to figure out what they are and answer them.
SBC?
SBDC, Small Business Development.
I think I went to like one meeting there with a guy who kind of had some good ideas, but I don't know if I got a ton out of it. Is that the Chamber of Commerce thing? Yeah, that was like, I had to fill out a form proving I was a U.S. citizen or something.
Yeah.
It was kind of a weird experience. I guess it can't hurt. I think it's free, right? It can't hurt. I'd recommend you try it. I tried it. I didn't get a ton out of it, but I think I came out with like one or two good ideas.
Yes.
You mean what is SaaS?
Yeah.
So it's software as a service. And basically, we provide kind of a SaaS model where if people want to be able to have a tool to build a dental website really easily and have everything just work. And the way that dental websites are constructed, our software just does out of the box. So that's the software. We sell that as a service. So every month people pay us $64 a month for the support and the upgrades to that software. So instead of just like downloading some software and installing it somewhere, you pay us on an ongoing basis. So we have recurring revenue. They get better support. They get features that are upgraded. Everything's kept up to date. And that's important for certain business models like ours, where you need to keep updating your site to make Google happy. So that's SaaS. Let me get to the side of the road. Go ahead. We didn't. Every time I've been asked to sign an NDA, I just kind of groan. And I've hated it. And like, you have to send it to the lawyer. And the lawyer wants to change like some small thing. And then their lawyer doesn't like that. Most of the time, I've had handshake agreements with people, and I've had surprisingly few issues, if any. I guess it really depends on how proprietary and how much damage somebody could have releasing your stuff, but my general inclination is to tell people and get feedback rather than keep it secret. Yeah, I guess it depends. I mean, I didn't have a lot of experience in actually practicing dentistry, but I had experience in marketing, and I leveraged that, and I had experience in software. It really depends. I mean, if you're really good at like alligator wrestling, I don't know how much you'll be able to offer to like accountants. But if there's some kind of, you know, if you have experience running a company, like in the dental community, there's a financial section for people to invest. Maybe you're really good at investing, and you just go in there and be useful. and there's a little ad at the bottom, not an ad, but in your signature, that's where you have your ad. That's where you explain what you do and how you do it. Really, you want your advice to be as closely tied to your services as possible. Oh, perfect. So talk about medical implications of household goods, and like, you better be wearing a mask when you do this, and this isn't organic, and this will kill you and give you cancer, or whatever you want to do. And I'm not sure who you're selling to, but if there are forums that talk about health implications of those goods, by all means, you have credibility as a physician to jump in there and do that. Yes, but those were largely locked up. We have a couple of larger competitors that have been around longer than us, and most of the dental associations are kind of a pay-for-play route. So if you want to strike a deal with them, they want a kickback from every new customer you bring in, which is, there's nothing inherently wrong with that, although it does present a potential conflict of interest. But they already had those deals locked up, so we had to seek another avenue. But that's not a bad idea if those opportunities are available to you. Oh, we do both still. We still have clients that pay us annually. We eventually, I think it just became easier, and there's less of it. You know, if you do it annually, you get a big bill once a year, and it becomes this kind of moment of truth for your product, and they have to really think about it. When it's monthly, it just kind of happens, and you know, you still have people that will cancel or that, you know, no longer need your services or there's a better fit for them. But I think annually forces a client to think because you're paying for it all at once. There may be services that make sense for that. I know some companies offer a discount if you pay annually. You could try to do it that way. But it ultimately probably depends on the cost of your product and why wouldn't you do it monthly? I guess it depends on the relationship you have with our customers. We just call them and say, hey, your credit card doesn't work. Do you want your website to still work? or do you want us to keep working on your marketing? And I mean, not to act like we're jerks about it, I mean, we've given people months. I remember we gave a client like 8 or 9 months that hadn't paid us. We just let it go. We paid it for it. And eventually he did pay us, and he's still a customer. And so we've been very lenient with that. And we've had a couple people that, you know, we technically lost money on. Big deal. The customers whose credit cards did expire or get stolen were happy. They didn't feel like they were getting pestered to pay us. And you still have the same problem annually. It's just punted 12 months. So you still have an issue with people's cards expiring or going away. I think I probably prefer monthly billing, and that's kind of what we favor today. Well, we deliver value. That's the only way you can really convince clients to keep paying you, because we don't have any contracts either. So clients can leave immediately. We have some clients that book a lot of marketing services and cancel the first month because they had to buy some equipment or they had a problem. But you have to continuously deliver value and prove to your customers that you're doing that. So that's where communication is important. We send out reports that are markedly better than our competitors, that are personally written by our staff, that explain, this is what we did to market your site. This is the results as far as we can tell. This is where we need your help. Because usually with our business, it's a bit of a partnership. We need the clients to do things in order for their marketing to work better. So there's a monthly conversation where we remind them what we did, what we're planning to do the next month, and what we need their assistance with. So I think communication and reminding people what you're doing, I probably need to learn more about your business to give you any intelligent advice on that. But in general, those are the things I would do to try to convince people to keep paying you. Make sure they're aware of the value. Yeah, we do. We have exclusivity agreements, so we won't take more than a couple dentists in the same area. Usually it's 2, maybe 3 in the same city. So if you're in like Parker, Colorado, we try to take 2, and we would try to take a male and a female dentist. About 19% of the population will make a healthcare decision based on gender. They will or will not go to a man or a woman. It just depends on the person. But 19% will make a decision like that. So ideally you have 2 clients in the same market that are very different. So one accepts every insurance under the sun, one is totally fee-for-service, one's a man, one's a woman. That's perfect. There's gonna be very little overlap there, and that's good. Yeah, that was very ad hoc. I mean, we tried, putting money into the platform was kind of slow and gradual, and we built things as needed. I tried to take on consulting gigs that we could leverage, that were building a feature that we wanted to build or had part of their thing building a feature. I just work more, but it's a line you have to walk on, and sometimes you do have to choose, and it's going to come at you at a cost of time. There's no other way around it if you're doing something else besides working on your business, but sometimes that's what you need to do to avoid raising money or avoid going bankrupt. No, and I probably should have. That we kind of learned the hard way. We did hire people that had come from backgrounds working for agencies, and that helped a lot, bringing some of the best practices and the worst and avoiding the worst practices they experienced at their previous agencies. But no, that's one thing looking back at it. I should have brought in a mentor or a consultant that had a lot of experience running an agency, because it was a very different type of business, and we had a lot of initial problems that we struggled through and had to, you know, sometimes lose money on or just get by with really great support. Again, for us, that was kind of a gut decision where we'd have a conversation amongst the staff. We would always tell people 2 to 3 clients per market, but we seldom go over 2 just to give ourselves some leeway. Because dentists would get a little upset if you sold it to every single dentist in that city. You can't really promise everybody to get them to the top of Google or to really help them with their ads. Eventually, you're going to have a conflict. So it really came down to how many people can we honestly feel like we can help? And usually that number was 2, in some cases 3. And it depends on the geography and the area and how affluent it is. It's kind of a tough decision to make. We, a little of both. I mean, we mostly posted content directly in the community. So I would write a thoughtful response to somebody's question and just post it right there. A lot of those we would recycle as blog posts, like especially if I'd answer the question 2 or 3 times in different ways. Sure. Then we would recycle it as a blog post or a white paper or content to use for inbound marketing. But mostly we would post content directly in the community or the forum. And a lot of communities have rules dictating that you have to do that. They don't want you linking off-site anyway. Mm-hmm. Which was one of that rules of that community.
You came across as being more sincere because you were generating your content specific to what was coming up in the
community. Oh, yes.
And not pushing.
And I was. I was completely sincere. I had a special place in my heart for dentists, having been exposed to so many of them. And if you have kind of a relationship or an affinity for your niche, that makes it a little bit easier to be sincere. But we really just wanted to help them answer questions and avoid getting ripped off. And eventually, we became a resource that they could go and trust, where that wouldn't happen. I mean, we've tried Facebook ads. That worked a little bit. We've gotten leads from there in a cost-effective manner. We tried Google AdWords. That didn't work that great. There's a lot of competition. We've tried just organic SEO and trying to get traffic. That's worked a little bit. We've tried LinkedIn ads. That didn't work at all. I tried Twitter ads. That didn't work at all. Really, I think, you need to have someone who has experience or can consult you in setting up these different paid advertising platforms. Is that what you're talking about, paid advertisements? Because that's what you need to scale. Partnerships are kind of the same way. You just need to think about different ways that you can get in front of your target niche audience. And you can obviously buy advertisements to reach them. You can go through partnerships and other companies to reach them. There may be influential speakers or individuals that have a connection, that are leaders of the tribe, so to speak, that you can appeal to or bring in as advisors if they're important enough to your company. And then you just kind of have to track everything and figure out where your leads come from and how you can expand your lead funnel. Does that answer your question? I think the first full-time employee was my assistant. Then we hired a project manager full-time. And then I don't really remember. It was just kind of as we needed more roles. To this date, all of our copywriters are still contractors. They all work part-time. They all work remote. That's the relationship they want, and that's fine. Our graphic designer is still a contractor. She has other work that she does. We have a couple developers that are part-time that work on their own projects. We have a couple people that prefer to be contractors for tax reasons that did have businesses that fit all the IRS criteria, and they wanted to retain that for tax purposes alone, and that was fine. So that was kind of what dictated who was what and what we hired for. And then, of course, the hiring decisions. If we couldn't find somebody who's a part-time contractor or it wasn't the right fit, we would hire full-time.
When you first started, did you focus on, Denver, or did you
just... No, we never focused. Our customers are very geographically diverse. And for our business, that made sense because you start talking to every dentist in Denver, you're going to have conflicts real fast. So we were virtual, all our sales were done over the phone, all our clients are diversified. I think that really depends on your business. If you're a VoIP company like FluentStream, which is in front of my face now, then it makes total sense to go local because you're not really competing with somebody by offering phone service to a competitor. They're gonna get phone service one way or the other. But with marketing, that was more sensitive. At the very beginning, I wanted to build a platform because I was a programmer and that's what programmers do. They don't make one-off projects. So that was kind of my mentality. I also realized that the cost for doing this would be a lot easier if we were always doing projects the same way and using the same software and the same methodology and the same system, and it would be a lot easier to do support and training. And if you're going to teach a dentist how to use a website, because almost all of our clients have never built a website before, and almost all of our clients will do some sort of updating on their own, which is a difficult task unless you have some kind of training program you can put in place. It's really difficult to make a training program when it's different every time. You have to figure it out when you're on the phone with this guy and then you sound like an idiot. So we have a system that everybody uses. It varies. So, I mean, at the very end, for clients who are still appealing to my dream of having them do it themselves, I think it's like $900, and they get a bunch of training and support and a crash course, and we help them make their site. Most clients want more value-added services, so if somebody wants to do search engine optimization, they want help with Facebook advertising campaigns and paid search campaigns, and they want custom graphic design and new logo and all the copywriting, then it starts to approach 10K. It just depends on the breadth of services that our clients want from us and how they want to be involved with us, and we give them a proposal.
Are your SaaS fees the same for all your clients then?
No, we have a couple clients that are grandfathered that were really early that are still paying the early prices, and we haven't had the heart to raise the money on them. As I said, always treat your beta customers really well. My dad is still skating by, not paying me anything. But he did put me through school, and I didn't have the courage to ask Uncle Joe to pay me after he gave me 10 grand and I flushed it down the drain. So there's a couple edge cases, but for the most part, yeah, everybody pays the same base monthly rate, and then there are options that you can add to that if you want them.
I have a question on one of your failures, or maybe not a failure, but your...
You want to talk about the Nintendo business?
No. I actually have a story on that one too, but your snowboarding business seemed like a good idea. What happened with that?
Well, I mean, we made some bad decisions about how we spent the money. We did get money from investors. It was basically friends, family, and fools. And we spent way too much money on legal fees. And I mean fools in the nicest possible terms. They weren't professional venture investors. They weren't angels. I still feel bad about like losing that money. But we didn't, you know, we were all young. I was 22. Didn't really know what I was doing. Still don't really know what I'm doing. But we spent way too much on legal fees. I greenlit an injection molding system that was like $30,000 or $40,000 that had to be scrapped after 2 weeks. It was a terrible decision. So that flushed a lot of money down the drain. And just kind of being naive in business, not getting buy-in from the manufacturers. We had one deal, we had several deals in Vermont torpedoed by the aerial tramway boards. Maybe probably are unaware of this, but every state has an aerial tramway board. I coincidentally have nothing but positive things to say about Colorado. We went to Aspen, and the manager at Aspen, this guy Hans, just took a picture of it, sent it to the tramway board, and we're like, we're installing this on the lift before the X Games. Are you guys cool? And they're like, yeah, done. In Maine, we had to sit down with the aerial tramway board guy in a Dunkin' Donuts, and he asked us some engineering questions and did a little due diligence to make sure we weren't complete idiots. And then he approved it. In Vermont, they went to our competitors in different states and threatened them with legal action, which they had no basis to do. Thankfully, that customer told them to, get out of here. And threatened our customers in different states and did everything they could to hold up the process and sabotage us. Similar experience in Pennsylvania. So dealing with these regulatory bodies, bad financial decisions and mismanagement just because of naivety in business and poor spending choices.
But the demand was there.
Kind of. I mean, some people, everybody liked the idea. The cost to produce it and get it to the market was questionable. Some people were willing to pay it. Some people wouldn't. If you want to license it, the patent's going to expire in like a year or two. Go for it. I'll be happy if you succeed. Any other questions? So the first part of your question is, I didn't. That turned out to be initially a lie. You end up working and being a slave to your business for a while, but now it's different. Now I can take off time. Now I have a lot more flexibility. Now we have staff that keeps things going if I'm gone. And you know the business has kind of gotten past its trajectory point where you can afford to do that. In the beginning, I would not have high expectations of this luxurious lifestyle of life and leisure and flights everywhere. You can still do that and work like I would go on trips and bring my laptop with me. I remember being in Switzerland on vacation visiting my wife's family, making a sales call in the bathroom of the place we were staying to a dentist on the other side of the country at like 11 o'clock at night. But I was willing to do that. So you can still, if you pick a business where you can take it with you to a certain extent, you can still have freedom of movement, but I don't think you'll have a lot of time initially. Eventually you can get there, but it will take time.
And that took roughly a year, year and a half, 2 years?
No. So, I mean, the business was started about 8 years ago, and that was the phase where I was fully, the first phase when I was fully employed was about 4 years, I guess. And that was working on nights and weekends in addition to a full-time job. So I didn't have tons of time, but I did have free time. And then after I quit my job, I initially had lots of time that I had to figure out what to do with. And that self-discipline becomes an issue. That's a challenge. I could give you some tips on that. But and then I did consulting on the side. And then eventually I started to focus slowly on the business. And then gradually things ramped up. Once I started to focus solely on the business, and I got office space in Galvanize, I was kind of in a mindset where I was totally focused on this and I was really all in. And I kind of burned my ships Columbus style when I did it, because I'm probably not employable for the same job I held 5 years ago. I wouldn't hire me for that job. I've been out of the software development business for quite a time. My development team actually cut off my access to the repository like a year ago and they switched to Git. And I think like a couple of weeks ago, I finally got a login, but I still haven't checked out any code. I don't have time anymore. So things will change quickly as you scale, but you'll be at a point for a while in the middle where you really have to put in the time. Don't slack then. Get to the cruising altitude, and then you can take some time later.
Anytime.
Yeah, we're actually, this is the first year we're actually doing that. Previously, we didn't, but this year for the Christmas party, we're flying people in. So we only have a couple people that are remote and out of state now. I think there's only like three or four people that are in that position, but we're flying them in for Christmas party this year. That feels good. That's a good thing. Go ahead.
You mentioned self-advice with self-discipline.
Yeah.
Self-employed.
Yeah. Do you want my tips for it or what I try to do?
Yeah.
So I'm still don't think I'm great at this, but my assistant will constantly badger me about things that I remind her to badger me about. And that's a good, it's really useful to have somebody else in your life reminding you to get things done. I used to make to-do lists, I still have to-do lists on paper, not on a computer, on paper that just sits on my desk and I can't avoid looking at it. Just sits on my desk and reminds me of the important things I need to do. And it is very gratifying to cross things off. And this is one little like mind hack, even like minimal things like send an email to some dude or something, just a little 5-minute accomplishment, write it down and then cross it off. You'll start to build this like mental inertia and it'll start to feel good and you'll feel like you're getting things done. There's nothing more frustrating than finishing a day and feeling like you got nothing done, which happens sometimes. And then, you know, learning to work when you're in the flow. Usually, when I was a software engineer, I would say that I would get like almost all of my work done for the week in one afternoon or one morning when I just happened to be in the zone. Same thing happens now, and when I'm in that, I try to, I'll cancel meetings or move things around and just keep working and working on what I'm doing. Also, don't try to multitask. That's one great thing I learned from Tim Ferriss's book. Try to set block time to accomplish a goal and get it done. Don't just respond to everything that comes in. You'll just be responding to stimulus all day and you'll never accomplish anything. You'll be distracted. Try to plan your day in advance and accomplish things, cross them off, and then review your progress at the end of the day. Try to do better the next day. So planning, to-do lists, focusing on one thing at a time, working sequentially instead of multitasking would be my advice for getting things done. Any other? Go ahead.
And when you first started the website or the business, how many competitors were there in the same field, and what did you do differently to get noticed?
I mean, looking back, I was aware of like a handful at the time, but there were probably 20 or 30 that I'm aware of now that existed then. We had a software platform and most of them didn't. They were boutique shops, so we had this advantage and we tried to sell.
We
had a technological back end. The companies that did have the technological back end that we did, the big players in that space that had thousands of customers and still are monsters, but are losing customers now because they didn't have customized content and it was all the same. and now they've oversold their markets and their customers are leaving, or they're going back to their customers and they're having the same problem that somebody asked about. How do you sell marketing services to so many clients in the same market? You can't, and they can't, and they're forcing their customers to either pay more money or
leave.
So
they're kind of like a WordPress kind of
a... No, the biggest companies did a platform like we did, but they did the same content for everybody. The smaller boutique companies would use WordPress or Joomla, but they could never achieve the scale or deliver the value at the same cost that we could, because it was more expensive for them to start up and it was more expensive for them to maintain their sites. So that was kind of our competitive advantage. We had the best of both worlds. We made customized content, but we used a platform. If I had to do it all over again, I would network better and get a better network a lot earlier. I would really seek out people's advice and try to build an advisory board from the beginning. And I would try to get a little bit more working experience before I started a company. I wanted to start a company before I was even in college. And I was convinced I'd be a millionaire by the time I was like 21. And that wasn't true. It's not true. But one thing I regret is not taking some job opportunities that would have given me a lot of experience and maybe waiting a couple of years. And I followed a pattern of like starting a company, losing all my money, going to work for somebody, regaining my money, starting another company, losing it, and then it just kept going until it finally worked. So you need to be sure of your abilities. You need to be sure that you really can do this. You need to be willing to risk it, and you need to have a fear of getting to the end of your career and not having done it, and that fear has to be greater than having tried and failed. And for me, I was most afraid of just, having a boring job. I turned down a job on Wall Street that would have paid me a lot of money when I was like 22 or 23, right after the snow rhino collapsed. And I didn't want to do it because I didn't want that career. I wanted to do something by myself. So I took another job that would give me skills and software that I could leverage later instead of just punching in numbers and selling stocks. So try to find jobs strategically that will teach you things that you feel you're not good at. If you feel like business planning and financial stuff is your weakness, get a job where you're going to have exposure to that. If you like coding or software stuff is your weakness, try to be a product manager, or start to take classes or learn that stuff on the side. You need to fill in your own holes with expertise, and it's better if you can get paid at the same time you're learning. I tried to do that with consulting projects, but that's one change I would make at the beginning. There is no guarantee of success. I can't tell you and promise you you'll ultimately be successful. It's a hard road, and there's a lot of risk of failure, but it can be done. And if you have a plan and you kind of take some of the advice and improve upon what my experiences were, you can mitigate your risks to a certain extent. You try to hire good people, and you try to give them enough work. It's a lot harder to keep people engaged that aren't in the office, but if you make good hiring decisions for people who are comfortable working remotely, and you can usually kind of check in on them a little bit more at the beginning, then you just let them go, and they're fine. That's worked out for me. I didn't. And I mean, besides working with family as my customers, I didn't. So I didn't want to take any more money from family either, which is another reason that led me to bootstrap. I guess it depends on your relationship. I know founders that are related that are very successful, and other ones that it's ruined the family relationship and the business. So that's a personal decision you have to make. I decided not to do it though. Somebody else? That's a tough question. That applies, I think, more to the in-house team. But sharing the successes with them, getting feedback, feeling like they have input and involvement in the job and the business, and they're kind of charting the direction of the company, is something I constantly try to do. Asking for ideas. I send out self-assessment surveys that asks how I'm screwing up, what I'm doing well, what I could be doing better. So I'm constantly asking for feedback from my staff. And the important thing is to actually do it. If you just ask for feedback and ignore it, then you'll stop getting feedback. You'll stop getting honest feedback. So you need to take it seriously and try your best to change it. I should probably wrap it up because we're a few minutes over, but I'm happy to stay for the next half hour or however long you guys need. Thanks again for coming, you guys.